All right, folks, we're going to start the meeting. So I call this meeting to order. Our first matter of business on the agenda is minutes review and approval for June 1st, June 22nd, July 13th, and August 3rd.
I don't think she was able to get those all completed before because they're not in the Dropbox, and I apologize for that. She's been trying very hard to get them all finished and keeps getting kind of shoved off to the side because they're a little bit less important.
Table it.
Table it. So the first public hearing tonight is for Barry Kaplan at 5 Divoli Way. The agenda as of Thursday had no DEP number. Is there a DEP number yet?
We do have a DEP number.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
1366.
Yeah. Perfect. That is great. Here.
Yeah.
Proceed.
So good evening. For the record, I'm Michael C. Camp, C. Camp Environmental Consulting, and I'm here tonight representing Mr. Barry Kaplan, who's with us. And this is for the tear down and the reconstruction of a home on 5 Divoli Way. There was going to be a reduction in the lot coverage in the impervious, a significant reduction. I think it's 500 and some square feet. In addition, obviously, the new structure will be on pilings, and it'll be approximately 4 feet above. The lowest support member will be approximately 4 feet above the base flood elevation, which is elevation 13. And the mean ground level is about 9 feet 6 inches, something like that. It's a pretty flat lot. Most of the lot is covered, if it's not covered with trees like eastern red cedar, it's mostly got beach grass, Nemophila corvigulata, and most of that will remain after the home is torn down and reconstructed. It'll be moved slightly closer to the main street there. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Sam, we'll start with you. Do you have anything in your review of the file that you would flag?
No questions from me.
Okay. Anything of note that you think we should pay attention to?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay.
I'd just like to note that Mr. Kaplan did go to the Zoning Board of Appeals for certain issues, and that's all been resolved. So. Once we get our order of conditions, we should be good to go.
Okay. Brian, you want to go first?
There's nothing that's jumping out yet. I'm getting the plans at the moment, but I mean, it looks pretty straightforward and easy, and you know, I don't have anything to complain about yet.
Okay. Dan?
We have the full architectural package, you know, all I've seen is just one elevation and the plan view.
Yeah, we just have the plan view and the elevation. We have the piling plan as well, but
right,
I didn't.
Right, but I mean, we've only got one elevation. It's kind of difficult to discern what's going on underneath and with all the touchdowns from the stairs and that sort of thing. It could be helpful for me to visualize what's going to happen there if we had. I mean, you could see there was, you know, elevations from four different sides, two sections.
Well, obviously the stairs are going to come down and touch the ground, and the pilings will, and the utility chase.
That might be helpful.
Yeah. This is a complete set.
Tim, do you have a plot plan that you could bring up?
The two plans that I just brought up on here, the elevations and the...
And then we have the existing conditions and the...
Plan view, those are the only two that I have.
So you're moving with the existing houses very, very close to the lot line in the eastern...
Correct.
The north, with the southeastern corner.
Yeah.
You're moving the whole structure closer to Old Point Road?
Correct.
So that large parking area that is currently out in front of that structure will be minimized?
Yes.
Okay.
Also, there's a concrete pad that will be removed. I believe the shed will be just moved. It's now on the...
I looked at it this morning. It doesn't look like it's movable.
It's not movable.
That's up to you guys.
Yeah.
I don't think it's gonna make the trip.
Yeah.
We're hoping it could, but this is, yeah.
But included with the complete NOI was the engineered plan. Yeah, at the bottom of that.
That's on page 18, Sam. There's a pilot plan.
Should be coming up shortly. A few good views, Sam. Yeah, here we go. That's the existing conditions, I believe.
Okay, yeah, there you go.
So you can see, the northeastern corner, like you said.
Yeah, so the drawn Davoli Way is not the actual Davoli Way. That shed is right on the street on Davoli Way. And there's a fence that runs east-west along Davoli Way.
Yes.
That is right on the street. I took my dog by there this morning. I live just up the street.
Uh-huh. And you determine that by?
Just walking it. But it's the street pavement is right, the pavement, existing pavement is right.
Well, this is based on the survey, so.
I got it.
Yeah.
I got it. I'm just
Yeah.
saying real life conditions versus
Yeah.
what the plan says, that's all. But the fact that you're moving it to the front.
Well, we show where the fence is. This is the fence here.
Right.
And then, and you say the pavement?
Runs right along the edge of the fence.
Okay.
Well, yeah, I mean.
Yeah, that's probably the pavement there.
Yeah, that light gray line.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, this is where.
I think the solid line, that's the very bold line, I believe that's the plot, the.
Property line.
The property line,
yeah.
Yes.
My property line goes in the middle of Johnson Road, so.
Yeah.
I get it. No, the fact that you're moving that up, again, I don't mean to jump in here.
No, you just.
The fact that you're moving it closer to Old Point Road is a bonus, as far as I'm concerned.
As well as raising it up.
Yeah.
Yeah. That'll be resilient for years to come.
I didn't see anything with your plans in the NOI. Sorry, I know I'm getting in line. You're not gonna have any type of fencing or screening below the structure of the house. It's gonna be completely open.
You can see there's like a.
Brings it down.
There's a partial wall.
Yep.
And then that's, I think it's about two or three feet above the.
Right.
The surface.
Yeah, so I'm just saying that.
It'll be open underneath that.
Correct. That's what I'm trying to say is that you're.
The water can come up underneath.
Some people will use up to 50% of the space. You're not using any. So that's what I was just trying to.
You can, they're leaving the 2-foot skirt available.
Correct, but.
But you are parking vehicles underneath it, correct?
That's the goal, yeah.
Yeah. And that will, that, so that is look, that view is looking from Old Point Road, correct?
Yes.
So the entrance to your property will be on Old Point Road, not on Davoli Way.
Right.
Which it pretty much is now.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
We've had past cases where people have not included things in their architectural plans and then when they're built, they put things there, so.
It looks to me like maybe there was a, they combined lots at one point, is that?
Before my time, I don't.
Yeah. And maybe that's why the address is Davoli Way.
I think it was probably before the fence was up.
Right. Just talk to the chief if you want to change it to Old Point Road.
Pete, do you have anything? Brian, have you figured out anything since sitting there?
No, I actually like it more as I was going through. I think this is a clean project, Mike. You did nice work. It's just the usual commentary about where does the dumpster go and the street construction tear down meeting and that kind of thing.
I think from walking that site this morning, there's plenty of room for the dumpster.
Yeah.
Plenty of room.
All right, now that I've seen this, it helps me a little bit understand in that view there. Hard to see from here, there is a
Yeah, you should have that view in that package as well.
But,
just doesn't have the elevations.
Now it doesn't have those. It doesn't actually show, but you've got on that particular drawing, but there is a storage space that's below the base flood elevation, breakaway floor.
Right.
Could you tell me how that all is gonna work?
I cannot. That's for the architect, perhaps, Mr. Kaplan, to explain.
Yeah, right, can you repeat the question?
So, I've been on the board a while, and I don't think I've seen this much stuff below the base flood elevation. I'm not saying it's not possible. I mean, it is AE. But it's pretty significant when I looked at some of those other sectional views. It appears there's like a whole corridor, closed-in corridor, and I'm not sure what the base flood elevation, so looking at this page here, let's see, so, now it says it's a workshop.
So that's an older plan that I happen to have with me. I didn't bring the current version up, but I do have that here.
So that is the looking at this, you can see the stairs going up a doorway. When you get on the other side of that door, what are you going to see?
It'll be a.
Is it like a walled-in corridor?
It's a corridor that you can turn into. Be better if I look it up here and just speak.
Most likely you hit a set of stairs.
Yeah, there's a set of stairs going up, it'll turn and go up again to the first level and then.
But that's all enclosed, correct?
Yes.
I'm just trying to get what we were supplied here, which may be I just want to find that, okay, this one's got a bubble. You know, with the various elevations, base flood elevation, low structural member, breakaway floor at 11. And it looks to me like that might, is that corridor at 11 too?
I actually don't know, because I haven't heard that term before, so.
So this is, at least on the plans that you're showing, this is what is called the unheated space. You show it as a workshop. It's a 14 by 16 area that's adjacent to the entrance into there.
It's been relabeled as an unheated space. You're allowed so many square feet of unheated storage space at that level, my understanding, the architect's understanding. And that was mislabeled.
Plus, it allows water to come in if it floods with the breakaway floor.
Well, I've never heard of that. How would you have 50 pounds per square foot to support? And then, how does it work? You know, I think it's a realistic question. It's one for the building inspector who has been out. I asked Sam to kind of go through the whole question of the flood proofing. We have a responsibility under the bylaw to ensure that you know, all the building code is followed as far as flood proofing goes. So just for me, I'm sort of having some questions. You know, we do have a thing where you come in, you know, you go through the entry door, but then the stairs just keep going up. There's not a big long corridor that's below flood level. You do have a couple of other staircases, so maybe you don't, it's not an egress question, but
wouldn't the,
I just have questions about the, you know, how is this going to meet the building code for floodproofing? Breakaway floor, do you need flood vents? What's going to happen if the breakaway walls start moving around. We've got a couple of columns holding up the landing up above. I just have some questions in regards to...
Can I ask what kind of flood level you're talking about possibly
having? The base flood elevation is 13. And,
base flood level is 11, that's it. Is it 13?
13.
Flood level is 13.
Is this 13. On the more updated set of plans? That little bubble there?
Yes, that's the latest version.
So that's, you know, those are all things that we tend to look at pretty closely.
Flood level is 13, the base of that floor is at 11.
That's a big space below the base flood elevation. I don't know if you need venting on the walls. That's the only other project that I'm familiar with. It wasn't on Plum Island even, but it was AE13, and they wanted the whole bottom floor, you know, the ground level enclosed. And they were able to do it, but they had to have vents. So the water comes in, the water goes out. And there's just detailing like that, I think, that's as far as our, you know, looking at the bylaw, making sure the floodproofing is the way it's supposed to be. That's kind of where I'm at with these questions.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I assume that's to take pressure off of the structure so that if water does happen to get that high, it can flow and not put pressure on walls.
And you don't flood your neighbors.
And you don't flood your neighbors.
You know, there,
my
there
neighbors
might
be a lot worse
be,
off if there's that much
yeah.
water.
Yeah.
There might be a question about whether, so if the ocean comes up, you're not going to raise the level of the ocean. That's not going to happen. But, you know, you might divert floodwaters onto adjoining property or something like that. That's kind of hard to figure out, but...
if I could just interject, you know that DEP is struggling with defining performance standards for land subject to coastal storm flowage.
Yeah.
And that's for the exact reason that you're talking about. The ocean is so big that if you have a structure that's taking up space, it's not going to affect the elevation of the ocean.
That's what I just said. But,
So that takes away that concern. So the concern is the safety of the people in the building, I believe. And I think that it comes under the purview of the building inspector, and that he makes sure that a building like this would meet the code and the flood resiliency. I apologize that I don't fully understand how the breakaway floor works, but I believe that the purpose of that is to allow the water to come in. And I remember seeing these videos of houses floating in one of the recent floods in Louisiana, and I said it's a good reason to open your doors when you got a flood coming, because you don't want your house to be a boat. You want the water to come in. So anyway, that's a
yeah. I mean, it's aside. You know, I don't think we're going to get any real answers to this until we were able to talk to the building inspector. But it is sort of our responsibility as well. You know, I mean, I assume he would not okay stuff that was not.
Yeah, I would doubt it. It would be a similar situation to a septic system.
We've seen a few of these things, and I've never seen a breakaway floor. When I'm thinking about it now, I think, the tide comes up, just pushes the flooring
right.
with the joist
right.
or something.
It could be
like
just
that.
Possible it's just sitting on something and not attached, and that way it would float up.
So like a reverse ceiling.
Yeah, right.
So I have another issue I'm just looking at is you've got these sort of mushroom sonotube things. Those are precast. There's several of these shown.
Yes.
I'm just wondering why you're just piling everywhere. You're going to have the guy there.
The pilings to support the building?
What's the plan here? So, like in this porch, see? There's these.
Yeah.
Those look like sort of precast.
Right.
Concrete.
Yeah, so
you gotta dig a muck a big hole.
Yeah.
And, you know, you're gonna have a lot of work going on.
Yeah.
Is the present house on a foundation?
Yeah.
So you're gonna have, you're gonna have to fill in the foundation hole. So maybe there, it's not an issue, but,
Well, it's in a different location, so we will be digging that, but I believe that probably the reason why this, the different construction is just less weight, just supporting the deck.
Yeah, I mean, it just seems like there could be opportunities to.
It could be, again, that's an older plan.
That's also for cost.
So I dug this out of my book, I just happen to have it, but that goes back many months.
Right, but I think in the stuff that we have, for instance, this version.
That's current.
You'll see some of those, some of the ancillary footings, the two, like I think, wherever there's the post going up to a porch up above, you know, that there's, those are the ones that seem to have the.
The big foot.
Yeah. And, you know, it may not be a big deal, but I do think,
I think they do that for cost.
We like to see, you know, as much as possible, just if you're digging, putting piles in, oftentimes I think you'll see these kind of things like wood piles or something, you know, instead of steel. Or cantilever, you've got a steel deck, you cantilever, but,
Are you suggesting we redesign the building?
Excuse me?
Are you suggesting that we redesign the building?
No, I'm just suggesting that I have questions about the use of Bigfoot when there might be other alternatives that are less, require less excavation, that type of thing.
Well, compared to tearing down the old structure, I think putting in a couple of those Bigfoot supports will be pretty minimal.
Could be. What's one other? Is the stockade fencing going to be replaced?
That stockade fencing is junk right now, so yes.
I mean, is it part of the this application?
No, it's not.
Okay, so. It just, going to all this trouble, it just doesn't seem to make much sense to me to put a stockade fence back, is what I'm getting at. We don't have any bylaw regulations to that effect, but other municipalities tend to, you know, Newburyport, if you replace a fence, you've got to make a compliant fence, so. We don't have that in regulation form yet, but I think it's a sensible thing that you're encouraging the free flow of sand and water.
Yeah, so it'd be higher off the ground. So
well, Newburyport does that. I mean, it's just, there's a whole thing with fences, you know.
That's not part of our application.
I understand. Leave that for another day, I guess.
But so is there anything you really want to answer for this
meeting? Well, I would like to, I think I have to hear something from the building inspector before we can move on this, I think. I mean, I'm sure he's, I don't even know if there's enough detail to supply for him to say, yeah, this is going to be compliant, you know.
Wouldn't that be something that would be part of the process of getting his approval anyway, though?
Yeah, it would, but we have, you know,
The way the bylaw is written, it's just the way the bylaw is written, so we have to follow it, is that we have to make sure that the building code is, you know, that when you give us details to approve it under this process, that the building code details are there, and it's up to snuff. So theoretically, even though, like, pure state WPA things, it's compliant, and we would say that, under our current town bylaw for Plum Island, we also need, we should not be approving things that would not be building code compliant. So,
but couldn't we vote on this to then say,
are you planning to start construction in the next month or 3 weeks?
No, but this is sort of the last step before we start getting more firm quotes on steel and all the other things that have to happen.
So what I'm hearing from Dan is that I don't think there's a truly substantive issue here, and you can just get the check off, and if we can wait 2 weeks, then we can get the check off. So we have to hear if there's any comments from the abutters, but a clear path forward might be to wait for the 2 weeks. We can talk to the building inspector, Sam can communicate with you or Michael in the meantime, and you'll know whether it's just coming in for a rubber stamp or if there's something you need to bring in just to show us for the next meeting. And then we can get you through real quick in 2 weeks, if that works for you.
That works for me.
Okay.
So you think the building inspector could look at it and have an answer for us that that's good?
When is he coming back?
He'll be back on Thursday morning, so I can talk to him about this Thursday morning.
Okay.
And
can I give you a call and remind you that?
Absolutely. Highly encouraged.
Okay. Does that sound like a good path forward, Dan?
I guess so. Maybe I'm, you know, I may be making a big deal about nothing, but again, I don't think I have seen.
I have less time than you, but from what I've seen, it's been the flood vents and what you were describing rather than a breakaway floor.
You know, and this, you know, I think it would be a different scenario if I'm looking at this correctly. We're on the other side of this now, but keep going. There you go. If I'm looking at this correctly, you go through that door, and you have an actual walled-in space, both sides, kind of a corridor, you get to another staircase, you start up. There's a door into the workshop or unheated storage area, it's been called both. That the fact that that's, like, it might be a different scenario, but that was just sort of a deck with an open railing, no wall. You know, it sort of makes a whole other space.
But the building inspector will be able to make a determination on that.
Well, if there's enough information available here, you know.
Dan, if I may, just from a guy who lives down the street from where this is, having that be walled in, I have no concern except for the homeowner having to get into their house. That's going to be that's the primary entrance into your home, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So let me tell you, anything that you can enclose there without causing any water issues is a bonus. And as long as it meets the building code and as long as it meets our wetland bylaw, I'm all for it. Because I store my firewood below my house. Go out there in January, it's like being in the middle of the tundra. It rains upside down out there. So for them to be able to get into their house in an enclosed area, I think from the plans that I looked at, those are the only two means of egress in the house. So you can't eliminate that.
Oh, there's actually three means.
But it back stairs too.
Yeah, yeah.
But
let's just keep it jurisdiction.
So I think the question is it walled off or could you open it with maybe balusters or something going up the stairs in the
I think the issue may be that that whole corridor, enclosed corridor, which is not habitable space, which may make a big difference, but that is all below base flood elevation too. So shouldn't that be breakaway?
Well, that's what my point was, is that the water could just come in if it wasn't walled off.
That's,
yeah.
It's just like you've got
right
underneath, you know, you see that all the time. It's just an open staircase going up underneath the house.
Right.
One touchdown, maybe a couple of posts or something.
Yeah, so if it meets whichever meets the building code, that's what we'll go with. And we'll wait for the building inspector to give us guidance on
that. For me.
Thank you. And are there any abutters or comments from the public? Anybody here for this? Okay. Sounds like we'll be continuing this. Oh, Brian, do you have one last thing?
Yeah, just if they're going to come back anyway, let's just make sure that the dumpster ends up on the drawing.
Yeah, we put a dumpster, just put a dumpster location on the drawing. I totally understand that there is room for it and everything looks good, as Brad said, but we do usually like to see it just on the drawing so we know where it's going to be.
Can we draw that in ourselves? Or do you
sure, yeah, okay. It's there. Yep, that's how it works.
Okay, great.
Yep.
Yeah, we'll take a continuance.
Okay, thank you very much.
What date would you like it to continue to? Because as of right now, the meeting on the 5th is still at 5 p.m. And Only three people in the room, actually only two people in the room have confirmed whether they'll be there. I don't know if you can make it on the 5th at 5 p.m. But as of right now, only three people can in the room can be.
Yeah, so what's the situation with the firehouse?
I've been waiting to hear back whether we'll have enough people for 5 p.m. If we'll have enough people for 5 p.m., we can keep it to that.
I would think that if we can get everybody here for a 7 p.m. meeting in the firehouse is preferable than having a 5 p.m. meeting where less people can make it. So I think it's probably best that we focus on having a meeting at the regularly scheduled time that we have meetings in a location that can do it than trying to winnow down the pool of commissioners that can make it.
Is the concern the audio?
The concern is just getting, being able to get everything set up appropriately for the meeting to be held elsewhere. This is, as of right now, this room is the only place permanently set up for meeting. So anything, any other location, everything would have to be, I would have to get all of the equipment over there and get it set up correctly.
Well, what I would say is that we need to set a meeting for a date and time certain, and we don't have to specify a location or whether or not it will be via Zoom, which we, I'm hopeful that our request to the board, the select board, will be handled by then, and we'll be meeting by Zoom. That would be my hope.
I know
you have no control
for
that. Yeah. So I think that barring knowing that we have a quorum, say you can. You, can you make it on the 5th at 5?
I responded yes.
You responded yes.
But
you said yes. Brian and I cannot.
Yeah.
Mary could not vote on this.
Yeah.
And Frank could not vote on this.
And was it 1 hour that we had the room for?
Yeah.
Frank can't. Oh, because they're not here. They're not here tonight. So it would be a question of who'd be.
Yeah. Hey,
so it's going to be. It's going to be 4 weeks, though, not 2 weeks.
Correct. That's what, or we say we're going to do it at 7 p.m. and figure out
at
a location. And I mean, we've done it in the past. We've had meetings in the firehouse in the past. So I think we work with IT between now and then to have the meeting
at 7.
At 7 on the 5th.
And then you won't be crunched for time too, Sam.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the four of you will be able to make it.
I think that Brian will be able to make it. All five of us can make it. Yeah. And then you guys will be able to get on your way. So I will entertain a motion.
Motion to postpone or to continue until the 5th.
At 7 p.m.
7 p.m.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Brian? Thumbs up.
Aye
as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much,
Jesse.
Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Sam.
Okay, next we have Adam True with Gadsden Lane LLC, 3 Gadsden Lane, Lot 3, DEP file number unissued as the time of the agenda, and NOI for permission to alter land within the 100-foot buffer zone to a bordering vegetated wetland. Work includes grading, a patio, a screen porch, a wall, well, and landscaping. Did we get a DEP number between?
We do. This is 1367.
Yep. Okay.
And I have a packet with a bunch of other information that they gathered. Sam,
and I saw, do we have a tear sheet on this?
It's got a tear sheet. It's got everything in there that you need.
Okay. And you're Mr. True?
I'm Adam True, yeah.
Great. Adam, thank you very much.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
The assist from Tom.
The assist from Tom, nice.
Can I have the...
So,
just twist that a little bit so Brian can see.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Thanks so much. Perfect.
Can you see that?
He's probably got it all loaded up too on his computer.
Yeah, and I'm doing the sharing as well. So.
Speaking of the fancy color.
Yeah.
All right. So. I kind of ran over this with the engineer today. He wasn't able to make it, and I'll do my best. I'm not a wetlands guy. But the overall boundary key map here, as you can see in outline in purple, lot 3 Gadsden Lane is also number 3, as the assessors deemed it. So this area here in yellow, just outside, just inside the 100-foot buffer is the area we're talking about. And it's roughly 22% of 5,700 square feet. And here's our flagged wetland. It's a, I don't know if I'm going to get this term right, it's a hillside wetland, and it's perennial. And this is sort of grading all the way down to, we get the limit of flood and the FEMA and the ACEC line on here as well. Down here we can see the home, and we're proposing to be about 7 or 8 feet into the buffer zone with the screen porch corner and potentially the corner of the patio. We're limiting our work. Our original shot was a little closer, but we got 53 feet would be the closest point in any given moment there. So in here would be grading for the rear of the home, removing trees. In this zone, highlighted in pink, we're looking to selectively clear trees. Only 6-inch caliber minus dead wood, unwanted trees essentially, but leave all the mature trees. And then within this 25 feet, we're only actually looking to do what I guess is the town's minimum standard, which is be able to go in and clean up anything that's on the floor that's 3 inches caliper or less. So small little sapling stuff, anything you'd like to clean up. And this may eventually be on the homeowner to deal with that, just as a maintenance thing. Wetland line here. The line for the selective clearing comes across and actually kind of peaks back up. And the reason being on that is we've got a drainage easement and stormwater flowage, and it flows over the area starting right out the center line and down through here, which we deemed during the subdivision process a filtered vegetative strip, basically an area to not be disturbed. It can be partially cleared, but it cannot be cleared. So that's why we peaked that up, to make sure we're not having to deal with that at all. Is there anything else? Any questions?
Where is Gadsden Lane? I'm not familiar with it.
It's not a road yet.
Yeah, so if you see on the locust map here,
is this behind the brick house on High Road?
Yes, that is, yep.
Okay,
yep.
Now I know where it is. Yep. Just follow your sign. That's all.
That's it. And
where's the existing house on this?
So, well, this right here, this foundation in this home is underway.
Where's the existing?
It's at the front of the lot.
The
this is way in the
brick
rear.
Would be in the locust plan. You can't see it on this.
This is basically as far back as they've cleared.
Yep.
And my other alternate sheets under here are just really showing septic plans sections.
So the rest of the subdivision is already approved?
Yes. Yep, this is now on the individual lotting basis. And something that we had also, said that we were doing during the process of the subdivision, that we would go with individual lots and notice of intent when they're being built out, essentially.
So you're going to be coming to us multiple times?
No.
This is the only lot that you have to?
Do you have two lots?
We do. We have two lots that would be in the area we're talking about, lot 3, lot 2. But lot 2 is much higher, and actually you can see this line, 100 foot. When you use the 100 foot buffer, it really just comes into an area that is of no need to clear or get down to. And there's actually no wetland as it tails all the way back. It just goes down to the...
down into the marsh.
Yes.
Yep.
Yep. It's kind of like flatter, more mature trees over here, hillside wetland, sort of coming in from the corner.
With the way that the land falls off behind that patio, are you putting any retaining walls or anything there?
We do have a retaining wall right here, mm-hmm. proposed, and that would be within the 50 feet. I think the retaining wall goes in about 18 feet into the buffer, just to simply keep and maintain the natural grades on the backside of the flow area here, so they don't have to steeply shoot up, like bring it off and then come back around the sides.
Are you bringing a lot of fill into that lot?
There'll be fill back here, yeah. We took the house, actually, the first shot at it was, the house was a little high, so the house was brought down by 18 inches. We could reduce the fill amount. I think the first plan, which you didn't see, but had filling and grading out to like within 30 feet of the wetlands. And well, I just thought that, why get that close if we don't need to? Keep 50 feet, you know, or 53 feet. And it just wasn't necessary either for what they wanted.
Sam, did you, we'll kind of get back into that, doing things in order, we got a little off there. Sam, did you have any comments or thoughts about this?
Nope.
Pete, you want to start on your end this time?
No, just want to make sure that this easement is, as we spoke about,
will
still stay in place, right?
Yes, exactly. Yep.
And we said we'll kind of work through that.
Is there anything else from the planning process that the...
Well, we negotiated a bit and everything's, we're there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Brad, do you have any other...
No, good. Thank you.
Looks, pretty sensible to me. The only couple things maybe where a little more detail might be nice is the erosion control looked pretty good, but I don't know what's, it didn't say what size silt sock.
Oh, the erosion control measure that's currently in place?
Well, the whatever's
yes.
on the plan that we...
Well, have you cut into the 100-yard foot buffer already?
No.
Right, so I guess he's saying the one that's shown
the new proposed.
I mean, the next page that we have
yes.
is a detail of,
yep.
you know,
it's
silt
a
fence with a silt sock.
Correct.
And
silt fence dug in.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably fine, but there's one area where you've got a well going in.
Right, so any areas that we've had, let's say low soil conditions, like where it's ledgy, because it is ledgy over there. So we had a hard time in a few spots getting the fencing in, did what we could. We ran the silt socks. What we did was run in site wood chips and went in front of the fence and a little bit behind the fence just to make sure that, you know, when there's only a few inches of soil, you can't really cut the morafi fence into it. So that's how we prevented any erosion. And we have a SWIP permit on the property, so we're also maintaining and actively weekly checking all the erosion control points within the entire project, so kind of another layer.
I'm just thinking where that well is going in, there's usually a lot of water.
A slew well, yep, exactly.
It's right next to the silt fence, so
yep.
we may have a condition just that you've got to have extra material.
Yeah, we were thinking sort of like wood chips, we thought of it ahead of time, it's sort of like a almost like a farm. Small retention pond berm, yeah, for while they're doing it to let it lay down after. Most of it's recycled, but you bring a bit of water there initially, and then it just kind of keeps recycling itself.
Yeah, I just think, you know, when that well's going in, there's potential for stuff to escape, but as long as you're equipped to deal with that, or, you know, you figured out how to deal with it, that's fine. And the sort of trimming of smaller vegetation, what's your hope in terms of what's going to grow there? Is this something that's going to occur kind of on a maintenance basis too? Or?
No, I think it's just this one time thinning, clearing, cleaning it up. It's a forest that would be like not considered fully mature. You know, it's sort of in its stages. So it's got under dead wood. It's got all sorts of things going on, but basically, the homeowner wants, you know, a little more view towards the marsh. That's their general objective. So there's going to be a lot less clearing work, you know, like, for instance, in this area here where we're saying we're clearing potentially everything, there is some trees that are not going. But down in here, there's a few trees that, you know, are smaller, that are all dead and hung up. So that's what they're looking to do, is just basically clean the woods up. I mean, they don't want to see, but not clear.
I mean, this is sort of the kind of place that the homeowner comes in and, you know, one of our concerns might be that they just slowly creep their way.
Well, I think it's under our control at this point, you know,
right.
Not theirs. We just, we'll go through and we'll do what we're doing. You know, I can't control what they do after, of course, but.
So I'll ask some follow-up questions to Dan. So yeah, the cover letter on the NOI spoke about invasive species, but I didn't see like a call out on what as a reason for doing it. But I didn't see any call out about what was being managed. And you kind of said it's more of a viewscape thing.
Correct. Yeah. We didn't really want to get into managing invasive species because I know that there's a whole protocol that goes along with it. So.
Yeah. What type of equipment are you proposing to bring in within 50 feet of the wetland?
Within 50 feet?
Yeah, so I think that I'm going to say like...
Hand cut only.
Okay, no equipment hand cut.
No equipment within this zone.
Yeah, so, and I love that, and just to clarify what he said when he was speaking is that the engineer actually, I feel like every time somebody brings something here, I'm like, what percentage of your buffer area are you using? And that 22% is the actual of the entire 100-foot buffer area on the property. So that was, I think that's in the intent is for that to be a finished yard.
Yes.
I assume afterwards. So I think that's acceptable. But I'm not seeing as much justification to go into, certainly within the 25-foot buffer, and start monkeying around in there for any real reason.
Well, the 25-foot buffer is just,
this is
as I understand it.
I'm just saying that.
Are you looking to do what you would be allowed to do without asking or without anything, you know? It's, from what I understand, you can go within 25 feet of the wetland and clear anything less than 3 inches of caliber. Just clean it up. That's it. I could be wrong. That was what I was told.
I don't know that we've ever permitted that.
I mean...
Hey, Ben, can I jump in here?
Yeah, please do, Brian.
Yeah, so in a manner of speaking, to deeply oversimplify the whole thing, there's no point to doing an invasive thing as a one-off. This needs to be either a full-blown plan that gets looped into the order condition, or just like this is a waste of time as a deposition.
Yeah, I think we're not talking about invasives, Brian. They've given up on that.
No, but look, I mean, that part of the thing I would want to encourage, you know, all of the, you know, if it really is that, I haven't been out there, I don't know if Sam's been out there, I don't know, you know, if it's a big percentage of what's out there, if an invasive plan would sort of provide what they're looking for without getting into all of the other botany and ecology questions, you know, maybe they can get what they want, like maybe there's some really big buckthorn. You know, that are, you know, huge and old, who's to say? But I think if they want to go down that road, I think it needs to be sort of thorough and long term. But, like, you know, as you sort of implied that my audio is not perfect, so I may have missed a few things. So apologies if I was repeating.
That's all right. Where, yeah, they don't intend to remove specific invasive species or do a protocol. We're just looking to, you know, limit the clearing to a caliper size or less. That's it. You clean up dead wood on the floor.
Right, and generally I'm going to be against that personally, unless they're invasive. So, you know, to Ben's point, I don't think there's, you know, the aesthetic thing generally.
Well, I think that it's certainly been done a lot of times. It's certainly been issued an order of conditions for partial thinnings and clearings of 6 inch caliper less to happen in this sort of area and zone. So I don't think it's outside the reach of what this board's approved before. And that would only be obviously this area here we're talking about too.
Yeah, I'm less concerned with that than I'm not in love with it, but I'm the 25-foot and in. I'm not.
That doesn't even have to be noted or, you know, detailed.
No, I guess you presented in a proposal to do clear things less than 3 inches in the 25-foot zone, and I think that what Brian and I are saying is that we would not be in favor of that.
Okay, we would not be in favor of that.
We would not be in favor of any disturbance within 25 feet of the BBW.
Okay.
I don't know how the other three feel. But...
lesser invasive, kill the invasive.
Think lesser invasive, kill the invasive. So in a way, what Brian was trying to say to really simplify it is that
condition the invasive removal only.
If you were to provide us a real plan of what's there and what you wanted to remove, then we could talk about, have a discussion about what you do in there. But without that, we're not really in a place to do it.
It's understandable. Well, with time being of the essence, like always, we want to get this moving. It's kind of hard to work in the back of this house with trees right there.
Absolutely.
At this point.
Yeah.
I don't think we can do anything. So
then the question that becomes is 6 inches or less good for people within in that 50 to 25 foot strip, or do we want to say deadwood only? That's what I would propose as an alternative.
I mean, is there potential for an actual open view that's going to last more than a few years? Or?
I believe so, yeah. Selective, it's kind of a, pretty narrow channel, but it's right down through about here.
Is it 6 inches or less?
6 inches or less.
And not through that whole area.
Which is, without going out and surveying everything, of course, is there's a lot of trees in this area over 6 inches.
Yeah. I've just done the drive-by.
Yeah.
I've walked.
A lot of eastern red cedar right through here.
Pictures?
There are no pictures.
Keepable.
No, I mean, area? It's too bad we don't have some pictures to just kind of show us what's there and that kind of thing. But
I guess I just didn't think it was, I didn't exactly know what was needed for information on the trees that are were there.
Here you go. Didn't you want to see the area?
Hey, Ben, do you want to do a sidewalk maybe? Would that help with it?
Well,
it's going to be that. I mean, you've walked. I've walked this.
I guess it's pretty hard to detail out a plan what's going on there in the trees.
It's just wild land.
It's impossible, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's that mix of, you can see there's a mix of deciduous and coniferous plants and trees. And so we're talking about back in here.
And there's a bit of stuff that's like, kind of like in the mid stages that's dead and choked out.
It's going to be the cedar. There's a lot of dead cedar and stuff like that.
Some of the cedar, not too many cedar, but like locust that like went up a little ways and then they're just dead and like all over the place, and some ash that got killed off.
Ash is not going to go anywhere.
Yeah.
It looks thick from the road.
Yeah, I mean
it's pretty thick. Yeah, it's not. It's thin. Not too thick in here. It's thicker when you see from here.
Right.
Yeah. And then it's very thick down through here. It really hasn't been touched. It's sort of a hillside, perennial wet.
So, Ben, what historically was the protocol within 25 foot?
Within 25 foot, we've generally not done anything. Within 50 feet, and like most recently, over by Governor's, we just did the subdivision there. And when we talked about cutting, those were more mature trees, but we did do several site walks to talk about which trees could be cut and which should be left. I don't think Brian's idea of a site walk is a bad one.
It might be because now the site's very different than the one planning the market, so it might be beneficial.
I believe that your father, Bill, or Cara do a site. I remember when you were just beginning work, I checked with the town to make sure that you, did you have a pre-construction meeting with the conservation agent at the time?
Was there a conservation
that's
agent
the
here
issue.
At the time?
That's the issue, really.
No, I think that Martha was filling in, or somebody was kind of, Joe was filling in, the engineer.
Because they were going to be constructing right up to the 100-foot buffer, so there was supposed to be pre-construction with the town. I did check in, and maybe it was with Martha at that point, because I did talk.
Yeah, we did have a pre-construction meeting before this whole thing started.
Yeah. Okay.
7 or 8 people.
I've actually never spoken to Kara, so
okay.
I have no idea of anything that she did.
This predated Kara. This would have been.
It was right in between Bill. I don't know if he ever went out there or not. I can ask him. I can find out.
Yep.
How much could she do in 2 weeks? That's what she was doing.
You would be very surprised. Oh, Kara?
Yeah.
Not much. and not much that there's
that
record
a, that
of.
That was a 180.
Especially.
Okay.
Well, if the 25-foot area is the issue, with anything doing anything in there, I think that can be removed or can be conditioned.
Let me ask you, let me ask you about the 6-inch caliper thing. Are you looking to go in and clear everything under 6-inch, or are you selectively thinning things that are under 6 inches?
No, selectively, yeah.
Okay.
So there's trees of value, like red cedars and stuff, that are younger and in good shape that should stay.
Okay.
Identify and do a sidewalk.
Identify
the trees and do a sidewalk, and then you'll have a feel.
I'm trying to see if there's a way to let him get going, because he's trying to get the project done.
If you'd like to provision that we don't do anything until you do a site provision.
Yep, I think that.
That makes sense, and then at least we can get this portion.
Yep, I think that makes. Okay, so somebody.
I don't know if Sam feels confident to do this, but we could perhaps have you flag everything that's going to be cut 25 to 50, and you would go out and just make sure it's kind of in line with what we're talking about, a partial clearing. It's not...
Brian and I are both right there.
It might be so much to flag. And I think if we can have a sidewalk and be a little conclusive about it, maybe flagging some of the flagship stuff or something, but there's a lot of different stuff in there going on.
I kind of like your idea there.
I don't have a problem with that if it...
Helps.
Okay.
Let's,
so somebody
let's use our conservation agent.
Yeah. So
effectively.
That's what I'm here for.
That'll trying to have a site work coordinator
I believe I totally just let us know when it is gonna happen if
anybody wants to go.
Okay, so somebody needs to condition this properly. Or make a motion. Are there any abutters here for this who would like to speak on it? All right.
I'm a little lost on.
Okay. I think where we're headed is that I will make a motion that we approve the proposed work up to the limit of work shown on the plan of grading where the substation is. There will be no work within the 25-foot buffer of the bordering vegetated wetland. In the area between 25 and 50 feet, the applicant will make an effort to flag the type of thinning he wants to do, and then review it with the conservation and any interested members prior to beginning work beyond the limit of graded work and clearing shown on that plan.
I second.
I was gonna say about that motion.
I second.
Okay. Good. All right. All those in favor?
Roll call
vote.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pete. Brian.
Yeah, I just wanted to, can we tweak the order conditions a little bit? So, to sort of say what you said, but sort of more clarity, to add a level of formality to that so that, there's a formal notification if and when they want to move beyond and do, so that it's in the order condition, very stepwise.
I think the way I worded it, Brian, is they cannot do any work beyond the shown limit of grading and erosion control, which would take them into that 50-foot buffer without getting approval of the Conservation Commission through their agent. So they have to do all that before they can do anything beyond that hard limit of work for the backyard.
Right, and I think it should be more than just a vote. I think your language ought to carry over to the order of conditions.
I think it is.
Yeah, that was the motion.
Okay.
To use that verbiage, that's
yes.
what you, okay.
Yes.
This is why you guys need a big microphone.
This is why we need
I think he's getting pieces of it.
I think so too, and I think in the future we'll either all be in one place or we'll all be on Zoom.
Yeah.
Okay, roll call vote. Brian. Dan.
Yes, but I would have a condition to add.
Oh, well, now we have to start over.
We do conditions afterwards.
Okay. Sorry, I messed up. Brad.
Yes.
Dan, you said I already? Sorry, I'm messing this all up.
Yeah, no, I just, I had the thing about making sure there's additional erosion control material for use in the way of the well should it be needed.
Okay, that would also be included.
Yeah. Yes.
Peter, yes. Myself, yes. Okay, so.
I was trying to save you with the stormwater prevention program because that's all in there. You can't, you know, that was kind of a condition of that thing is that you can't have anything going on. So it kind of captures it, but extra wordage doesn't hurt us.
Okay.
You know?
Awesome. Yep. Have you had to deal with the NOI process before?
Yes.
Okay, so you know that she's going to take a little bit to write up the orders.
She's going to draft, yeah.
She's going to draft, she's going to send it to you, and being an NOI, you cannot start until 10 business days after.
After the
year.
I'm very familiar.
Okay, cool.
Thank you very much.
Have a great night, Mr. Chris. Thank you.
Thanks, Adam.
Thank you. Do you need anything else? Just email me. All right. Thanks.
Matter of confusion.
Just before we keep going, I can get all of your signatures tonight, but Brian, when you get a chance, whenever you get a chance, I probably won't have this done by the end of the week, but if you can, by the end of at least next week, come in and sign this sheet.
Yeah. You know, I've got an interest in heading back out there into the woods whenever you figure that out, so.
Okay.
Maybe you bring those with you if that time it worked out.
Okay. Yeah, I will. I'll try to get that set up to take a walk out there, soon.
He's got to do the
yeah,
work on his end as well.
Yeah.
Let's do a Friday lunch, right?
I don't work on Fridays.
All right. Next up, Town of Newbury, 31 Plum Island Boulevard, DEP file unissued. A continued NOI to convert an existing single-family dwelling into a municipal bathhouse with interior improvements, including the removal and reinstallation of the concrete entry to meet ADA access requirements, creating an ADA accessible ramp to the municipal bathhouse.
Tracy has requested a continuance for that to October 19th.
Okay. To continue to the 19th.
Second.
All in favor? Oh, roll call vote, Brian.
Aye.
Brad.
Aye.
Dan.
Yes.
Pete.
Yes.
Myself also.
Excellent.
All right.
Thank you.
Cricket Lane LLC, 55 Pearson Drive, DEP file number 050-1355. A continued NOI to construct 24 single-family homes with 800 feet of roadway, common septic system, water lines, sewer lines, and stormwater management system. Roadway includes limited crossing, wetland filling, and replacement with work in the buffer zone. This has been continued from the previous meeting, and the applicant has requested a continuance to the 10-19-2021 meeting.
Moved to continue to 10-19-2021 at 7 o'clock.
Second.
Roll call vote. Brian.
Aye.
Brad.
Aye.
Dan.
Yeah.
Pete.
Yes.
Myself, I have. Yes. Coughlin Shea Builders, 7 Larkin Road, DP file number 050-1360. A continued ANRAD to determine if areas within a resource area can be classified as isolated land subject to flooding. Continued from the previous meeting. I do not see a representative from Coughlin Shea Builders.
So they requested a continuance as well. When the plan was to have the meeting on the 5th at 5 p.m., I notified TJ that we wouldn't be able to hear it until the 19th. If we want to continue it to the 5th, though, I'm sure he would be okay with that. It was kind of administrative at this point, just to get it sent through.
We were just waiting on a few lines to be added to the plan.
Yep, which correct. I believe I did get some updated plans for that should be in the Dropbox.
So let's continue to October 5th at 7 p.m.
Okay. Continue the hearing to October 5th at
7.
Roll call vote, Brian.
Aye.
Brad.
Aye.
Dan.
Yes.
Pete.
Yes.
And myself, yes.
Excellent.
And now, David Manti, 0 Pine Island Road, Lot 5, DEP number 050-1330. a continued NOI to construct a dock, pier, ramp, and floating dock within Salt Marsh Resource Area and the ACEC.
Good evening.
Hi, Tom.
Tom Hughes, Chief Environmental, here with Mr. Ranty. One thing that I'm not 100% sure on, I know we've got, I think, 4 eligible voters, because Mr. Duffin came in. And then what I don't know, because not all your minutes from when this was filed up through now are available, I don't know whether we actually have a working quorum or not. I think we do, because I think nobody's missed more than one meeting. But what I wanted to offer, to be safe, is we can present everything real quickly tonight, and then we could just re-notify abutters and republish in the paper, which would then make all members eligible to vote.
Restart the clock.
Yeah. It basically restarts. It restarts the, we basically do a quick redo of the hearing, and then everybody can vote. And that would clear the quorum issue.
It would clear the quorum issue.
If there even is an issue, we'd have to go back through all the minutes to make sure.
Correct.
And I wasn't able to do that before tonight. So I'm sitting here kind of not sure. Do any of you...
Well, you haven't done an active presentation on this since
We were here in
March.
July, but if it was discussed, if it was any more than a raise your hand and continue, that's a hearing.
I believe that's all we've had. We haven't had any other discussion.
In July, you were here for another thing, and we said, Tom, since you're here, do you have anything
right.
to say?
And
you said, no, I don't have anything to say. We're requesting...
Right, no, but we did give a presentation in June.
That
I don't know that you were here for that, and you didn't watch the hearing, right? That was
I was
Fish
here.
Fish and Wildlife was here.
No, I may have missed that. I mean, you're right. I may have missed that. I missed that one, Tom. I was not there for that one.
Right.
I have not watched it.
Because Fish and Wildlife was here, and Nancy Powell was here for something else.
Yep.
And she expressed a concern that the refuge had some concerns and was unaware of this because the...
No, I was there for that one.
Okay.
I was there for
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I was going to say, I believe you were there at the meeting in June. I wasn't, but...
I was there for that. I thought there was a meeting that I missed that they said they had comments.
Then I went back and forth with Matt, the refuge manager, and he tried to get out there. He never did.
Yep.
His bigger issue was that when the lot was sold by the town, his Fish and Wildlife in Newbury was never made aware of it.
Yep.
Hadley might have known, but he had money and... You know, he was just upset because he could have bought the property, and unfortunately, he didn't. So
to get very briefly way outside my jurisdiction,
yeah,
that does not surprise me. The Region 5 at headquarters.
No, I know Hadley is
yep.
real estate people, and
anyway.
So regardless, so we're open to re-notifying. You know, it's been so long since we applied. Re-notifying, just doing that to be safe, but going through just to go through. What we presented before, to kind of remind you, is we made changes to the plan based on the marine fisheries comments, based on any feedback or input we got. That is, we have a 3-foot walkway that then goes to a 2-foot wide sort of step down walkway to a 20-foot gangway. And then this is a 4x8 float, which has skids set to give 30-inch minimum clearance underneath it. The surface is all through flow, so not only do we have the 1.5-to-1 ratio up in the air, we're also doing through flow, so the combination of the two really means that there's an awful lot of light and everything getting underneath this. Instead of stairs, we're using a removable ship's ladder to get down from that walkway down onto the marsh surface on this side. In response to comments at the last hearing about, well, when you're not there, other people are going to tie up to the float, go up the ramp, and go out and wander around the marsh. And, you know, the trampling was a concern. What we've done is we will be adding a locking gate up on here. It'll have a passcode, and we'll provide the passcode to the harbor master, to public safety, to Fish and Wildlife, to really anybody who's got a legitimate reason to be out there for, like, Audubon doing pepperweed work, Greenbelt, folks who have a legitimate purpose to be out there would be happy to give them access. Most of the time, like, the refuge goes out in kayak, and it's limited what they could bring. There may be a time when they want to bring something a little bit heavier into the marsh, and this would be a way that they could do it. And certainly the harbor master, anybody else, police, whatever, that is an appropriate public entity or NGO that would be appropriate, we give access to. Mr. Manti's already given access to Audubon to do pepperweed work out there. So the other issue that we talked about very briefly that you asked about during the continuance was the water quality cert issue. We reached out to DEP. DEP has now followed up, I believe, with the agent.
Yes.
And confirmed that a water quality cert, a separate water quality cert, is not needed. DEP did have a couple very important pieces to them. One is that our helical posts aren't any wider than 2 inches, which they won't be, and we'd be happy to accept a condition on that. And the other thing is the 1.5 to 1 height to width ratio, so that we have that as a minimum. And they said with that, that wouldn't be required and they would be good with it. So Natural Heritage issued an uptake letter on it. So we kind of, everything, you know, in terms of, you know, the DEP issues, I think are all resolved. We've done what we can to make it as sensitive as it can be. I know it's in the middle of the marsh. I know that's a tough thing for some of you guys to be thinking about, but it is something that allows Mr. Manti in a more environmentally friendly way to access the property that he owns than landing a boat on it to get in there. Yeah, I mean, it's over time, less impact to the marsh, and I think there is an added benefit in giving access to folks who are out there, you know, potentially doing meaningful research in the marsh. You know, some research you just can't do. I'm not saying that this is proposed for the site, but there's a lot of talk about doing research on thin layer deposition and things like that, and most of the sites where that's being looked at are right next to the upland, because you can't really get into the heart of the marsh with a deposition source. This might be a way to do small plots or something like that if somebody came up with a realistic plan. I mean, and anything like that, Mr. Manti's committed to working with folks, you know, obviously provided it has your approval. But so with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions. But if you guys think it's a good idea for us to renotice, you know, we can do that. We can run the paper. And
with the exception of Brad, can the four of you vote on this?
I think so.
My gut says yes, but Mr. Manti was here some nights. I wasn't, and I just don't have a record that says, you know, that each of the four of you were, you know, missed no more than one meeting. So, you know, that's...
Yeah, let's go through and get questions and comments from the commission, and then we'll take that up afterwards, I think.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. Sam, you get to start off all the time.
Where the plans reflect the requirements from DEP, when I spoke with Kyle, he explained the requirements to me. I relayed that to Tom as well as Mr. Manti, and it appears to me that they are complying with those requirements that DEP has set forth. I have no issues, no questions.
Brian, I'm going to do you first since you're on the interwebs.
All right. So everybody, you know, has given their blessing and put in their details, and the result, you know, is, you know, for lack of a better term, it seems a bit on the thin and flimsy side for docks, right? And so this is going to be a great fair weather dock, but you know, what is the risk of a washout? What is the risk of being ripped out? What's the storm resistance on this thing? I mean, you know, putting it in and having it useful on a bright sunny day is one thing, but, you know, how is this thing going to weather the winter, weather, you know, really high tide? I mean, you know, what else is going on here in those scenarios?
So we do show the highest observed tide, which is the basically the king tide elevation of 6.1, which does not get up to the walkway elevation. But let's say we have a big storm, water gets in there. The through-flow decking does totally become relevant at that point because it has an awful lot less uplift than a standard board decking. If you Google through-flow decking, you can actually see installations where they show the wave actually running through the through-flow decking. And the thin profile of the helical pipes also tends to not pick up a lot of, you know, a lot of resistance, so the water should be able to flow around it. The, you know, could this thing, you know, when a big storm get hit by debris and get knocked around? Yeah, but so could every other dock out there. The reason that we have the L shape is to give it a little bit more structural integrity. If all we had was a single walkway, then it's a lot, it can't really withstand different horizontal forces as much. When you make the L, it gives it some more resistance. I tend to think it's going to stand up pretty well to the normal course of weather that we get out there. But like any dock that you guys have ever permitted, could it get damaged? Absolutely. But I think it's a fairly resilient structure.
Okay. And then the other question sort of is, you know, you've addressed the various erosion concerns of, you know, wave action and all that, but do you have a sense of what sort of the natural erosion is on that waterway? I mean, what's the lifespan of this dock?
So, it's an excellent question. I think that the cleaving off of creek banks is the way that the salt marsh deals with climate change. It cleaves off sediment, and then in the winter, the ice brings it back up, sets it in the marsh, spreads out. We're in a global warming scenario, so, you know, climate change, the cleaving off, you know, is going to continue. I don't think we have a full rate on that. However, did not appear to be an area where it is just cleaving off in big chunks right now. What we are trying to do is trying to stay back. This is the bank edge here, and we keep this up and we clear with the gangway. So we've got, I don't have the scale, well actually, so here's plus 40, 30. So we're about 8 to 10 feet back from the bank with our leading edge of the permanent structure. So we're giving a lot of room, but at some point, given what I'm seeing in the marsh and everything I'm reading about how the marsh behaves with climate change, at some point that will reach that. But I think we're certainly pretty, we've got a decent distance there.
Okay. And also, I presume I know the answer to this, but is there any special maintenance required by this particular detailed construction in this particular location, or is this just a dock and you ignore it and it's fine?
I imagine when you go out there in the spring and you look and you make sure everything's straight, I don't imagine it needs regular maintenance or tuning up. Really what it is at the end of the season you wait for king tide and you put the ramp onto the float and you tow it all out of there. And in the spring, you wait for a king tide and you tow it all in and connect it back up. The only maintenance that I'm aware of that is fairly routine on a helical anchoring system that's being used here is you want to check those every year. You don't just put them in and leave them. You do want to make sure that they're tight. You might have to twist them in. If you're in deeper water, people have to send divers down every year to check them. Here, it's just a matter of being out there alone.
Okay. And then my final comment is just sort of an open-ended observation. All of the permitting bodies that have seen this have, suggested changes and asked for things and whatnot. And I think that, as Tom just pointed out, the future isn't certain. And so I think that in some way, the order of conditions, presuming one is granted, the order of conditions ought to have some sort of insurance policy, for lack of a better term. What if it doesn't behave as expected, and what if, this doesn't pan out? I think that sort of an annual or every other year kind of checking in to see if it's still permittable, or to see if there's restoration that needs to take place, or just to sort of keep an eye on it, would be something that I think would be worth doing.
Could I suggest that maybe a photograph at the end of each season? I'd like to do it while the marsh is still green, right? So you can see that there's good life. So say by like September 15th every year. And in the event that the leading edge of the walkway platform becomes within, let's say, 4 feet of the bank by the bank's erosion, that the applicant has to come into the commission with a plan for how to modify the structure accordingly, which I would envision would just be initially probably removing the first post and shortening that, and maybe you just do that over time. But perhaps we could have some kind of trigger where we have to come back to you if the
I think that's a good starting point, but I want to turn it over to everybody else.
Sure. I can do very little comment on Tom. I really applaud the job you've done, Mr. Manti, all the efforts you've gone through. I just don't think this is, because of the connections to the ACEC regs through the WBPA, I don't think this is a permittable structure. And that's just what it comes down to. And I've just been trying to figure out this whole quorum issue. I think the issue you have with re-notifying is that if you pull this and re-notify, you become subject to the commission's dock policy, which came into effect after Mr. Manti originally filed. So that's something for you to consider too.
I'm not sure that's certain, because this does happen in other projects where we run out of quorum, and when you re-notify, it's an administrative thing that essentially restarts the quorum process. Right, and there's no new DEP number. The filing date remains the original filing
date. You're just re-notified, you're not re-notified. Okay.
But whether or not that policy would apply or not,
yeah,
wasn't really something I was thinking about.
Yeah, I was more saying, if you haven't thought about it, it might be something to think about.
I would want to discuss that with the commission, that if we re-notify, we're not getting a new filing number, and our original filing date on the DEP NOI chart doesn't change. So it would be my initial thought that policy wouldn't apply, and I would ask the commission's deference to the fact that was adopted after this was filed.
I guess what I would say is that regardless of whether it was policy or not, I think those connections between the WPA and the ACEC regs exist within the existing statutes. So if Mr. Manti wanted to ask for his money back from the town, I would be right there. I would go into town, into the offices downstairs, and ask him. But I don't think that this is I don't think you can be permitted. I think there's a loophole that people aren't enforcing, and that there shouldn't be, and that reading the law, there isn't a permittable structure there. So I know you disagree with me.
No, it's not just that, but also DEP has reviewed this and conveyed to the town Correct. They're the ones that sort of are the keepers of the Wetland Protection Act.
They are, however, they are the keepers of the Wetlands Protection Act, but they're not the keepers of the ACEC reg, and they're choosing not to look at it. So if they want to say you're wrong and give everybody a chance to appeal, like if CZM wants to appeal, they can appeal. They're the ones who enforce the ACEC regs. If they want to appeal, they can. In the past I've asked you to send files to CZM and get their official comments, because I think I know, but have you done that here? I can ask you to do that now. I'll say, I'll approve it if CZM says it's fine.
Yeah,
I'll happily approve it.
So with the CZM part, CZM is not a reviewing entity on these. And
that's the loophole.
No, it's not a loophole. I mean, so I disagree that it's a loophole. I think that the way the regulatory structure around docs is they're only prohibited from an ACEC in the event that there's not already a management plan that then would allow them.
Correct.
So since there's not a management plan, the way the state looks at it is the Section 10 docs are smaller, they have less impact, and those are allowable, but nothing can get a full-on Chapter 91. You can't get a full-on permanent Chapter 91 structure. And that's the way the state has implemented that policy. It's not and I doubt that the residents of Newbury would have voted, you know, when they did to try to get this set as an ACEC, if it meant that they couldn't have any docks on the Parker, they couldn't have any docks, you know.
It doesn't mean that. It just means they have to go through the process to have docks on the Parker, which they have not done, even though some people have tried to do it.
Right. No.
So
I mean,
I think that's a straw man. I could throw a straw man out there and said that if there was something here that triggered a PCN and CZM did have an opportunity to comment on this because it would trigger a PCN, what do you think they would say?
Right, but they're involved in negotiating where the cutoff is on SVN versus PCN, and that happens every 4 to 5 years. And they determined in that process that the SVN docks are small enough in impact that they don't get to that level. So I think it's a nuanced policy rather than it being no docks versus, you know, all docks. It's only these Section 10 ones that are lower impact are allowed.
Yeah. I've had a lot of conversations with people at DEP, with people at CZM. That's not the message I've gotten from CZM.
Right.
So again, I think that's just a difference in opinion right now. So I think this is like a completely sensible plan. I applaud all of the efforts that have been made. Like were I to think it permittable, I agree with some of the things Brian and other people are going to say, but I would be voting to permit it. But I simply don't see the avenue to permit it in my mind. But that's just me. So other than that, I'm going to be quiet.
I don't have anything. I'm very quiet.
Excuse myself.
Other than a green notice, and I think it's a good way to go. I think that as long as it's a continuation of the original application, I think it's a smart move to have a quorum.
I mean, I think we probably have a quorum right now, but I just can't document it. But aside from that, I also think that it's not a bad idea just because people, you know, it's been, since February, right before COVID hit, I think is when it was filed. I think it was February 2020.
November 19.
Was it November?
No, it was November 2020.
Was it?
So then you guys didn't have a first hearing on it because if you remember, you stopped having hearings.
I apologize, Mr. McKay. I thought you came back in the fall.
No, but then, so that's the thing, is then we, Mr. Manti came back in the fall. We had to get a boat out there during COVID, get a crew out there. So everything has been like flowing molasses on this thing. And then, you know, I had a few health issues. My wife had a few health issues over the summer. It's like, you know. So we're here, and we've tried to do everything we can. I recognize this is a really sensitive location, and, you know, and I've said this to Mr. Manti, you know, I wish Fish and Wildlife had bought it. No doubt, right? But they didn't, and Mr. Manti bought it, and I do believe he has a right to be able to get to his property, and it should be done in an ecologically safe way. And I think this is more ecologically sound than landing a boat, you know, repeatedly. And Mr. Manti's going to be out there a lot of weekends fishing, and he's going to get there one way or the other, right? And at the hearing we had over the summer, neighbors have made it very clear you're not going over our property to get there. I understand that, I mean, you've walked out there, but anyhow, so Mr. Manti is going to be accessing the property. He'll be doing it by boat, one way or the other.
Yep.
So I understand your concerns. I understand your interpretation. I disagree with it, but I respect where you're coming from on it.
Yep. Likewise.
But I would want, I guess, an agreement among the members present that if we do renotice, that we wouldn't end up introducing the policy that was adopted after this was filed. Otherwise, I would just take the risk that I think if I were a betting man, I'd be right that we do have a quorum that can vote. I just don't have the documentation because your minutes aren't up to date. So.
I think that I certainly have no issues with if you guys just are simply refiling this, retaining the original DEP number, and you're not resubmitting your plans. I think
is a new legal ad, and we send letters.
I wasn't saying that as like a gotcha thing. I was just saying that as like, oh crap, like that's a legit plan and the right way to do it, but I don't want to have you stumble over something you didn't think about.
No, what
so
it
I
would
think
mean
it,
is,
I think you're fine. I think
right.
I don't think we need to plan
we would,
for it.
We would come back on the 5th, having notified people. And we would go through the plan again, one more time,
yep.
to all the members present, and then everybody at the table then could vote. Yep. So,
Dan, do you have any other feedback for between now and the 5th?
Just a question, is there anything, you know, like a note on the plan or some part of a narrative that talks about the winter storage?
That certainly could be a condition, and
you'd be happy with the condition that the floating gangway have to be stored off-site.
100%. Yeah. No, would it be easier to slide the gangway up on there? Yeah, but we'd be happy to accept that condition. That's done all the time. And Mr. Mandy, that's fairly standard.
Yes, I thought we had mentioned that somewhere.
Yeah, I know. I had talked
about that. No, I'd be removing the floating gangway.
Why don't we just plan to add that as a condition when we vote?
Yeah.
Construction impact,
So for construction impact, there's a couple things. Where we're putting this and where we cited it, and I had talked about this in prior hearings, this is an area where there's some high tide bush, and so it's not the dense Spartina. There's some separation. So the actual posts, when they're put in, will be as best as possible put next to but not on the veg. We have a little bit of wiggle room where we can just kind of adjust it. We'll lay it out and try to make sure that we're not impacting the vegetation with the pipes themselves. First of all, the through-flow decking comes pre-sized. There will be, some work done on site to build the frame for it, but as much as possible, things will be pre-cut before we bring them out there. And any waste will be taken out, and the cutting would happen on a boat, so the sawdust ends up on the boat. So we would do no cutting on the marsh. If for any reason something had to be trimmed on the thing, we would put a tarp or something down. So we don't want any piece of sawdust in the marsh as part of it. All waste would be removed on the boat. The helicals are typically put in either by hand with a big long bar or with a two-cycle thing that's held by two people, similar to the augers that you dig. But it's all handheld thing. We're not bringing a bobcat or anything out on the marsh. Everything's going to come in on boat, leave on boat, and I'd be happy to, we would do the pre-construction meeting and we could provide photographs at the end of construction.
All fueling and refueling on the boat.
What's that?
All fueling and refueling of a two-cycle engine would be on the boat rather than on the marsh.
Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And we may not even use a two-cycle engine, but those are the two methods. I think the ideal is you just put a long rod through and you get two guys and twist it in. you'd probably get more torque that way too. And if you want to say no two-cycle engine, that's fine.
So, but you're going to leave that conditioning up to us, or is that included in your opinion somewhere?
So that we, I do have in my letter, I think I talked about how we would be adjusting the pile or, you know, around the vegetation. In terms of the actual method for installing those helical posts, if we're going to continue to the next meeting so that we can renotice, I will confirm the method of installation. And if I can have a couple quick notes thrown on the plan, I'll do that. But we're happy to accept any kind of conditions like that in the process. You know, we recognize it's a sensitive area, and we are trying to get this to really thread the needle as best we can.
I don't see any other members of the public, so clear on that front. Thank you for sticking with us through so many meetings, Mr. Mahoney.
Thank you, guys.
Tom said in the last instance, thanks to the commissioners. Are there any other comments before we continue to the next meeting?
Yeah, Ben, this might just be bad audio. Is there a letter that you are asking for that we're going to get, or what's the story with the ACEC? Are we going to follow through on that?
I think the way that it's left with it would be in time, tell me if you disagree, but I said that my issue right now is needing to see something from, this is my issue as a singular commissioner, is needing to see something from CZM to say it's okay. Were he to provide that, then I think that everything I've heard from other commission members and from Tom is completely appropriate and is the right thing to do. So were he to provide that between now and then I would vote in approval for it, I think. But barring that, I don't think it's permittable structure. He can take his chances with the other commission members however he sees fit. I guess it's the way I'm leaving
right.
That, Brian. I'm the only one who said that.
Were you going to get that letter? Were you going to go after that? Or are you going to pass?
I'm likely going to pass. I want to give it some thought, but CZM is not an agency that has a role within the Wetland Protection Act. And we have the agency that does have a role that has reviewed it, has looked it over, has told us what we need to do to have it meet, in their opinion, the Wetland Protection Act. And, you know, DEP is named in the Wetland Protection Act. You know, they are the agency and the entity, and they're telling the commission staff that they believe this
right.
is permissible. So going after that letter from CZM, it just seems like a quagmire to get into, and it's not really relevant to the regulations, although Ben and I have a disagreement on that one bit of the regulations, but it's an ACEC rate.
And the WPA is such a clear and concise document.
So I would like to make a motion to
please.
Continue this to the 5th of October.
My response to that is that, as far as I understand, you know, if a conservation commission issues a denial based on a lack of information, you know, it's not restricted to the WPA relevant agency. You know, if it's considered a lack of information and the body does not have the information that they feel makes the complete picture upon which they can make a vote, you know, it doesn't matter if they're in the WPA, you know, ecosystem or not.
You have to be applying the Wetland Protection Act performance standards that apply to this project, and the ACEC performance standard that says no dock is not in the Wetland Protection Act. So you're going, requiring information that goes outside the regulations that you're implementing would frankly be not supported by.
Right. The inverse is also, the converse is also true. If we do not feel that we can make an educated assessment of whether or not a regulation is being dealt with accordingly, you know, so on and so forth. Like, if we just don't have the information to make an informed decision on what's in front of us, then we don't have enough information to make an informed decision.
I'll interject just to say that I think what it sounds like is that maybe there are two commissioners that you may want to think about the CZM letter for, and that, but I don't think we're going to make any productive inroads into, like, the theory and practice of Wetlands Protection Act.
Right. It's understood. But again, you have the implementing agency, so we're not gonna change.
I'm not saying what you should do. I'm just trying to say that I'm all three of us could sit around and talk WPA for an hour and probably get very
little.
No,
I hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
It sort of feels like what you guys are doing is implementing the policy that was adopted after the filing, which is that CZM letter.
I would say that what I'm doing is that the policy was when I finally got around to putting everything in words,
right.
But I believed beforehand that to be the case, and I think I've given you that feedback
prior
to the policy.
Right. Fair enough.
So I'm just voting what I have always felt to be my interpretation of the WPA and how it connects to the ACC.
Okay. No, fair enough.
Yeah.
So we've
So I think I did hear a motion to continue till October 5th at 7 p.m.
Okay.
I did. Is there a second on that?
I can't vote.
Yes.
Dan is seconded. Roll call vote. Brian.
Aye.
Dan.
Yes.
Pete.
Yes.
Myself. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for very good, and as I said, great work on all of this.
Yeah, no problem. And I appreciate your position. So, Kara, are you writing legalized?
Sam.
No, Sam.
It's all right. It's okay. It's late.
No, I heard you talk about that, Kara, earlier. My head is spinning. So the legal ads, are you guys writing those nowadays?
Yep. We can write it, and either when we get the confirmation for the price for it, we can let you know.
I have an account. They'll just bill it.
Then they'll just bill it straight to you. We'll write it. We'll send it out and everything.
There was probably an old legal ad in the file somewhere.
Yeah.
That you
I think I just saw it. So.
Right. So if you guys can take care of that, I'll get the abutters list and we'll we'll re-notice for that next one, and then see you guys then.
Thank you, Tom.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Manzi.
Thank you, guys.
Should have charged Adam for the rental.
I almost made a joke. Okay, next up, we are on to the COC portion of the agenda. Certificates of Compliance, Kerry Marshall, 3 Plum Bush Downs, DEP file number 050-1002, a request for a COC for an open order of conditions. That is incredibly vague, almost like the WPA.
Yes.
Sam, what do we have?
So it was a notice of intent, or an order of conditions, sorry, that was issued to... I believe to raise the existing house that was out there and build a new one upon pilings. Just give me 1 second and I will make sure that I have that correct. But I believe that's what it was, and I did go out there last week, I think. And did a site inspection, and based off of the plans that, so raise existing single family dwelling, construct a new single family dwelling upon pilings. Based off of my inspection, everything was built almost exactly what it looks like in the plans that were shown. It looks pretty much identical, and there is nothing out there that raises any red flags for me.
And for 3 Plum Bush, did we have any, no dune grass planting there at that location?
Nope, I don't believe there was anything.
There was vegetation plants, and they followed that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but there was nothing like massive, no.
I think the only possible concern could be just excess gravel brought in to make parking areas that wasn't originally on the plan. It's almost like it's in the salt marsh.
Based on what I saw out there, I mean, the renter that's out there right now had her car out there, and I pulled up right behind her. There's about enough room on that specific lot
Didn't look like they went haywire.
No, it is based off of what the plans showed for the existing conditions and what's out there now, it really isn't all that different from what it was.
I'll move to issue the certificate of compliance for 3 Bush.
Roll call vote, Brian.
Aye.
Brad.
Aye.
Dan.
Yep.
Pete.
Yes.
Yes as well.
And I do have one more thing before we get to that last little.
Okay, Sam, what is it?
For 21 Cottage Road, at the meeting on September 7th, it was, I believe, the final decision was to have him withdraw the notice of intent, which I don't believe the notice of intent was ever actually filed in the first place, because there is absolutely nothing on DEP. I have a notice of intent, but there was nothing on DEP.
And it did
it's
not,
never
did he send
been,
the town a check?
I saw fee schedules, but I didn't see anything that showed that there was a payment
right.
there.
Yep.
So I believe the last comment was to have him withdraw the notice of intent, which that should be all set, and to have me do a site inspection to ensure compliance with the enforcement order. Based off of the enforcement order, there is a lot of stuff that has not been done. So all of the structures have been removed. That's all set. All of the non-organic work materials have been removed. That's all set. There are still a lot of wood chips out there from where the fabric tent was on the metal poles, on the metal frame, as well as, not a ton, but as well as out into some of the trails that were constructed. And there were conditions in the enforcement order saying that the wetland area that was impacted needed to be seeded. That has definitely not been done. And that there was supposed to be a report from a wetland scientist after that work was completed, after the seeding work was completed. And since the seeding work was never done, there's no summary report from a wetland scientist. So I guess take that information as you will. I did draft a letter that outlines all of that, that says that the removal of the structures and the non-organic wood work materials, that's all in compliance with the enforcement order, but nothing else is.
So do you send another enforcement order?
I think the letter suffices to say you still have not.
Right.
You said
right.
You wrote a letter
so
and said you've not met
so
the terms.
Yeah, you don't need to show us the letter. As long as that's
oh,
your,
no, what happened to
your
it?
Bag. That's all right.
I don't know what happened to the letter.
It's okay, so
I don't
you've written a letter saying this is what you have done. This
right,
is what you have
basically
not done.
The letter outlines what was in the enforcement order. It outlines what he did comply with, what he didn't comply with, and then at the very end it says, you know, in accordance with the enforcement order, I find you to be in partial compliance based off of my site inspection. And if there's any verbiage that you'd like me to add, as far as like you know, doing the restoration within a certain time frame.
I think that it might, you guys can chime in, but I think what would be appropriate to add is that at least there's verbiage that says provide us a schedule for when the rest of this will be completed.
Within
21, and no later
21
at,
days,
at,
2 weeks or whatever.
Yeah, I think by the October 5th meeting, so we can get this thing nipped in the, just keep it moving.
Yeah, maybe we should ask them to come back into the October 5th meeting and say, wait a minute, you came here, you told us one thing, and we sent our conservation agent out, and what you told us is not true. Do you just not understand what was required?
I think there may have been a bit of an issue with the communication breakdown with Bill leaving and then Kara only being here for 2 weeks and all of the time that there was no one in my position.
So we're trying to give this guy the benefit of the doubt.
Giving him a little bit of leeway with all the issues that there were, but still requiring compliance with that enforcement order. So
And that's why I'm saying, let's keep it on the leash 2 weeks. Doesn't have to have it done in 2 weeks, but needs to tell us when it's going to be done by.
So 2 weeks.
Not only the schedule, but what it is specifically.
She's telling him what needs to be done.
Right. So by October 5th, he needs to submit some sort of plan, some sort of schedule showing when he's planning on getting all of the restoration, getting the rest of everything.
And I might not use the word partial compliance. Let's say you're still not.
Yeah, I think that's also, I agree with Brad on that.
All right.
You're either compliant or you're not compliant.
Okay.
To a degree.
We all happy?
Yeah, I mean, do we need to, we don't need to.
I don't think we need to.
I don't, no, because it wasn't, it's not like a notice of intent or anything, it's just the enforcement order. I just need to issue the letter, but I wanted to pass it with you guys first.
I agree.
Before I sent anything.
Thanks for staying on top of
this. Seeing as I'm sending it on your, on the behalf of the commission. All right.
Okay.
Do you have stuff you want us to sign?
I do have stuff for you to
and
sign.
And we have one more.
And
you only have one more?
We have
yep.
one more item of business. Maybe you want to bring it up on screen, Sam?
Of course, it's not going to be in here.
It's no, it's in
yes,
there. I just opened it up, too. It says there. Yeah. All right.
So I've been looking through like the Mac website and everything for templates that they have for different things. And one thing that I found that I thought was very interesting was this template for a meeting schedule. And it also includes some requirements and like a sort of checklist for what goes into an application. So this is something that would be updated quarterly. By calendar year, not fiscal year. So for every 3 months of the year, a schedule would go out showing the meeting date and the deadline to submit materials, which is 2 weeks prior to the meeting by noon. And then everything underneath that just kind of gives you a little bit of an outline of the meeting, unless otherwise posted, that's where they're held and at what time. And then multiple times over the entire page, it says that applicants should contact my office prior to submittal, and some a general outline of what applications include. And I am including a requirement for electronic copies of everything, because in the event that if we go back to Zoom meetings, we need electronic copies to be able to share with everyone. I've had a lot of issues so far with not files just seem to go missing every once in a while. Having electronic copies of everything is invaluable. So that's included in there.
Is this a place where you request a number of copies of, you know, hard copy?
I usually tell people two.
Yeah, you might include something.
Include that in there. Yeah, so.
Eight.
All right. To include hard
copies,
two copies
two.
Of everything. Yeah. And then there is a note that the checklist should not be considered complete, and that kind of reiterates that you should come in and talk to me to discuss any specifics for a project, because not every project is the same. And
some may not require.
Right. You know, some need extensive plans, some can just be, you know, a hand-drawn sketch of this is kind of what we have out here, this is what we're planning on doing, you know, for like very minor projects, things that would be involved in say like an RDA where not much is changing. And then some additional little note at the bottom stating that submittal by the deadline doesn't guarantee that your hearing will occur on the corresponding date. Because my plan going forward is to not have us here until 11 o'clock ever again, because that is a really, really long day. ideally, I would kind of be able to judge as best I can how long certain things are going to take, and if it's, you know, say it's something like Cricket Lane where it's taking 45 minutes to an hour of the meeting, you know, that takes up so much time, and everything that gets added after that
To move to the next.
It will either get bumped to the next meeting or, I don't know.
We voted in, I believe, a 10 p.m. curfew.
Oh, really?
Did we not, Brian?
We voted that in, but we also can't bump people. They need to go on the agenda as a 21-day application. They have to be put on a schedule in 21 days in the middle.
So we can.
But we just voted that we would continue things out.
Yeah, so just to notify that, yes, it's gonna show up on the agenda, but we're not gonna discuss it because the agenda's already very full. So basically put it on the agenda to say, we're gonna bump it to the next meeting. We're gonna continue it to the next meeting.
Open and continue.
Right.
So we do a continuing because there's no DEP number or something to that effect.
Yeah.
As a method of following.
Yeah. Tim, I think this looks great. We've been talking about having something like this for a long time, so thank you for doing it. It's really awesome.
Yeah, as I've said to a number of people since I got here, my big goal right now is to try and get things to a point where we're running things efficiently, effectively, and as painlessly as possible
would be
beneficial to everyone.
Having electronic submissions, you can then put them on the website.
That's my plan over the next couple weeks is to kind of set something up similar to what Martha has with the planning board and the ZBA that, you know, we kind of have like a sub page that has especially large projects to be able to. Do you know if, I know the ZBA mostly handles large stuff, but is that something that they do like small projects with too? Like if it's just, you know, say it was just an RDA to.
I don't know what the ZBA does.
Okay. But yeah, definitely at least for like the really, really big projects, things like Cricket Lane, the dam removal, the Larkin Road culvert, stuff like that, that, you know, a lot of people tend to show up and rally for that to get that up on the website and everything.
So I guess I would move to vote to approve this schedule and template.
Second.
All right, roll call vote, Ryan.
Hold on. I want to vote to approve like the idea here, but like for instance, the legal notice is something that Sam does. That's not part of an application.
Right, but it's still something that needs to be
included
because it is part of the application. So it is something that we still discuss with applicants when they come in, that we let them know that they have to do the abutters notifications, they have to be sent certified mail with return receipts, they have to do the legal notice, but we typically do it, but applicants have the option to do it themselves as well.
Right. What I think you should do is be more precise with your language, because a submittal to you is an application, but a complete filing that we can open is a different thing. So they should have a complete application to you that maybe they're check accounted, you know, and so then we can't open the meeting, right? And so there's a difference between those things. And a legal notice, if you're going to be doing the legal notice, then it's not fair to put it under an application. Because if you get somebody coming in to do an RDA, and you know they're looking at this as gospel, and to you it's just kind of, you know, wiggle room, you know, I think it needs to be a little bit more tied down so that you don't create as much confusion as you thought.
Brian, I think in all fairness, it says legal notice proof, not legal notice, and so I think that is different. I think that kind of subverts your argument. And she pointed out, she says numerous times that come talk to me before you do anything. And that's, you know, people should be following those instructions to come talk to her, so she can explain the finer points of some of these. I think that this is a pretty solid form.
It's a great thing.
You don't have to vote for it, because I think she's got four votes over here.
It's a checklist. It's not verbatim. It's not all encompassing.
Just to kind of clarify things a little bit, obviously, you know, people like Tom Hughes, Mike Seacamp, people who do work in town all the time, they get it. They know what the process is. This is more for
The guy over.
Yeah, the average Joe who says, I want to, you know, do all the work myself and I don't want to get a consultant. I want to.
How about this? I think it's really good. It's a great place. Brian, take 2 weeks. Give Sam any revisions. Concrete revisions. Don't tell Sam how it should be different. Tell Sam what you want changed. Provide precise wording. And we can vote on that version on October 5th if you have an issue.
Hold on. I'm going to actually propose something completely different. I think you should just take it as it is and sort of have it as a living document rather than as something set in stone.
Right, and that is the... Yeah, that is the plan, is to... I mean, none of this stuff is like... It's not the concrete, this is how it's going to be forever, because the schedule stuff is going to change. So, you know, every time I go to repost it, or if someone sees something and I, you know, start to see that, wow, every single person who comes in is asking me questions that, you know, I need to clarify stuff, or people just don't seem to really be picking up on it or understanding, then I can kind of change it.
Just
so
put
it,
rev control on it.
Yep, exactly.
This is rev zero.
Yep.
I mean, there's a whole...
Yeah.
Another checklist you could have.
For Pullman. That's what I was going to say. I want
right,
to get this
yeah.
done. Let's vote this through. Let's vote this through.
Yeah, so just to be
okay.
clear, I'm going to vote to like, support this. I just want it to get better.
Okay.
Okay.
So, Pete.
Yes.
Brad.
Yes.
Dan.
Yes.
Brian.
Yeah.
Ben. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Unless there are any other matters that everybody wants to talk about or needs to talk about on camera.
I motion to adjourn.
I second that.
Roll call vote. Pete.
Yes.
Brad.
Yes.
Dan.
Yes.
Brian.
That's down.
Yes. Okay. This meeting is adjourned. Thank you, gentlemen and ladies.
Yes.